dy by dx. Okay. This quantity is tending to 0. Okay. This quantity is also tending to 0. Are you getting this point? But this ratio can still be a finite quantity. But what finite quantity we don't know, that's why we start calling it as indeterminate. Right? Let's say I talk about the velocity of a car at a given instant of time. Let's say you are going somewhere on your car, correct? Let's say the travel was between 9 to 10 p.m. in the night. And I asked you exactly how fast was your car traveling at 9:30 p.m. Now, how would a person who doesn't know calculus try to address this question? He'll say, okay, exactly at 9:30.0001 second, how much did my car move? Divided by 0.0001 second, right? That would be the velocity. But this 0.0001, which I'm saying, it can further be reduced. It can be brought as close to zero as possible. So if the time is very small, won't the distance also be very small? So this ratio, will that be very small? Need not be. Your car may be traveling at 100 kilometers per hour. Correct? So the ratio of two small quantities cannot be found out till we know how small are those quantities. And thereby limit is helping us. But if this quantity is exactly zero, your car is stopping there. There is no displacement in the car. So even if you take 0.00001 second, the displacement is zero. The car is having no velocity at all. So in this case, when I write this, for JEE function, if I am trying to find out the right hand derivative at 2, so when you say GIF of 2 plus H minus 2 by H, it is actually 2 minus 2 by H, which is exactly 0. Correct? And it is supported by the graph also. If you see the graph, this is the graph at 2, right? Okay? Sorry, this is the graph at 1. This is the graph at 2. Okay? So if you take a point slightly right of 2, the slope of this line, what will be the slope of this line? 0, because that will be parallel to your x-axis. Yes or no? Okay. Now if I ask you, what is the left hand derivative at 2? What will you do? GIF of 2 minus h minus 2 by negative h. Correct? Now who will tell me what is GIF of 2 minus h? All of you agree to that? Slightly less than 2. Let's say 1.999999. Take GIF of that, you're going to get 1. So you're going to get 1 minus 2, correct? Divided by minus h, which is actually 1 by h. So can I say this is tending to infinity? And that is happening because if I connect a point 2 with a point just left to 2, this line will have infinite slope that will almost be vertical to the x-axis. Now I can say a parallel to the y-axis. So are these two values same, 0 and infinity? No. So here is an instance where you realize because of a discontinuity occurring at 2, or for that matter any integer points with respect to JEE function, my function will not have a unique tangent. In this case, I am getting two different slopes, indicative of the fact that there cannot be a unique tangent. Yes or no, Prithvi? So there is no unique tangent. That means from the very basic definition that I wrote, it must have a unique tangent with a finite slope that is null and void. So we say that the function will not be differentiable. So here is the rule that I want you all to note down. If a function f of x is discontinuous at x equal to a, it implies f of x is not differentiable at x equal to a. And this is the prime reason why we always check the continuity first before we check the differentiability of a function at x equal to a. So make it a habit, whenever a question comes to you about discussing the differentiability, always the root goes via continuity. So pehle continuity test karenge hum log. We'll do the continuity test first and then we'll go to the differentiability test. Okay? But in this case, you must also realize that if a function is differentiable, it must be continuous. But if the function is discontinuous, it will definitely be non-differentiable, correct? So here, very important thing that you should note down, if f of x is differentiable at x equal to a, implies f of x is definitely continuous at x equal to a. But vice versa, that is, if f of x is continuous at x equal to a, f of x may or may not be differentiable at x equal to a. Is it fine? So differentiability ensures continuity, but does continuity ensure differentiability?
No.
But if you are able to figure out the function is discontinuous at point x equal to a, you can abandon the process there itself and say it is non-differentiable. Is that fine? This is a very, very important theory that we actually consider before we test the differentiability of the function. Now let us take another situation where the function will not be differentiable. Let's take the graph of mod of x function. Mod of x graph is a V-shaped graph like this, correct? Yes or no? Let's say I want to check whether my function is differentiable at x equal to 0 or not. Is it continuous at 0?
Yes.
Had it been discontinuous at 0, I would have directly said not differentiable at 0. But unfortunately, it is continuous at 0 and hence we have to do the differentiability test. Correct? Now, if I find out the left hand derivative at 0, what expression will I write down? Tell me. Limit h tending to 0. In fact, this 0 is 0 plus, by the way. Let me tell you. Because when we are finding a left hand derivative, we are automatically subtracting h. That means we are coming left to x point, isn't it? So in this case, what will I write? F of 0 minus h minus f of 0 by negative h. This is what I am going to write.
Take h is always 0 plus, right? So even when you are doing right hand derivative, you are doing 0 plus h, which will again be your h 0 positive.
So for that h has to be positive. Yeah. But just by stating the fact that h is tending to 0, can you say that it is 0 plus or 0 minus?
No.
So that's why I have to mention it. No. Right? Many books also have seen they don't mention it. Because they think that h is already treated as a positive quantity, very small positive quantity. But when you say h tending to 0, it doesn't actually imply that. Yeah, sure.
So what do you want to track it with the limit of x tending to 0 plus f of x minus f of 0 by x minus x minus a. I mean, I'm going by the general general way of expressing.
Yes, x tending to a plus f of x minus f of a by x minus a.
So
that's what you're saying?
In the end, when you express x is equal to x minus a, that time you get this expression.
Yeah. When you say x is a plus h, but h has to be a positive quantity, there you have to mention it.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyways, this will not affect your calculation though. Don't be scared that you have to put an extra expression over here. Now, all of you know the definition of mod x function. Mod x function is defined as x when x is greater than or equal to 0 and negative x when x is less than 0, right?
Yeah.
Right? So if I ask you, what is the value of f of 0 minus h, means you are slightly less than 0, what would the function give it to you? It will give you minus of whatever input you have made to it, right? So you have made an input of negative h to it. Negative of negative h will become positive h. So can I say this is positive h? What is f of 0? 0. What is negative h? Negative h. So my answer will ultimately become negative 1. You know what does it signify? It actually signifies the slope of the tangent drawn by choosing a point slightly left of 0. See, here you actually chose a point 0 minus. Yes or no? And when you make a tangent line like this, that tangent line will have a slope of negative 1. Right? Because angle of inclination is 135 degrees there. Correct? Yes or no? Any question, Sushinta? Any question? Okay. On the other hand, if I try to find out the right hand derivative at 0, please note in the exam, in the school exam, you have to write it in the same way as I am writing right now. Okay? Of course, for JEE and all, I'll tell you what is the shortcut that we normally take. So, left hand derivative is already minus 1. What is the right hand derivative? Right hand derivative, as per the definition, would be limit h tending to 0, f of 0 plus h minus f of 0 by h, correct? Now tell me what will be f of 0 plus h. 0 plus h means I am slightly higher than 0. Which definition will I follow?
The first one.
So whatever input I give, it will return the same input to me. So I am inputting 0 plus h, so that means it will return 0 plus h to me. Minus f0 will be 0 divided by h. What does this give me? It gives me 1 as the answer, signifying the fact that if I take a point slightly to the right of 0 and construct a tangent, you can see the pink tangent that has a slope of plus 1. So if two slopes means two tangents. So the unique criteria is violated. Right? Remember I told you there has to be a unique tangent if you are saying it is differentiable at that point. Right? So here also we say the function is not differentiable at this point. Now mathematically we say that LHD and RHD, they are not the same in this case. So when left hand derivative and right hand derivative values are not same, your function will exhibit a kind of corner at that point. Correct? So wherever you see a kind of a kink, under all these scenarios of the graph, the function will become non-differentiable at such points. And of course, where you see discontinuity also. Right? So if you ask a layman what does differentiability mean to him, he will say it's the absence of discontinuity, it's the absence of any corner, it's the absence of any cusp, it's the absence of any kink on the graph at that point. Right? As a layman, you should know this. Right? You'll remember this for the rest of the life. All those things which you see around here are all mathematical way of saying it. Okay. Left hand limit not equal to right hand limit is a mathematical way of saying that there is a break there. There is a discontinuity. Okay. Is that fine? Can you give me some examples where a function is discontinuous at a point because of a formation of a corner, cusp or a kink? At least two examples give me. Mod x is something which I already gave you. Apart from this, give me two more examples.
Mod of log x,
which point? You should always mention the point. At x equal to 1? Mod of log x at x equal to 1. So he says, if I draw the mod of log x function, I am assuming log x means log x to the base e, the graph would be like this. Yes or no? Earlier it was supposed to be like this, but because of the modding that happened, it got reflected up. So what is getting formed over here? A kind of a corner. We can say a cusp also, correct? So in this case, at x equal to 1, this function will not be differentiable. Correct? Another example could be sine of mod x. Okay. How is the graph of sine of mod x? Let's say at x equal to 0, x equal to 1, and this is at x equal to 0. At x equal to 0, the graph of this would look like this. Okay, you have the response with you. Everybody please keep your phone ready with you, not to chat, to check your WhatsApp. Mod of sine x would be non-differentiable at all multiples of pi, because you can clearly see the cusps getting formed at these points. Cusp like this.
So let's say the any function where you mirror a general function on either side of the line, that would be non-differentiable at all.
If you talk about mod per se, here's a very valid point. Shriram is saying, if I'm not wrong, he's saying that wherever a function is crossing the x-axis and going to the negative side and you mod it there, it will show a corner at that point. For example, mod x. Correct? Mod x was becoming 0 at 0. X was becoming 0 at 0. The moment you mod it, it gets reflected up, thereby having an abrupt change in the direction. The abrupt change in the direction creates a non-differentiability point at 0. Sine x was becoming 0 at 0. It was becoming 0 at pi. It was becoming 0 at 2 pi. It was becoming 0 at negative pi. The moment you mod it there, at those points, non-differentiability will occur. Mod of cos x. Where will the non-differentiability occur? Pi by 2. 3 pi by 2. Mod of x minus a. Where will the non-differentiability occur? At a.
If you mod y instead of x, it's going to become non-differentiable at certain points along the y-axis. So, I mean, depending on the function.
Yes.
Even
tan of
mod x.
Yeah.
At zero.
Wherever it is becoming zero, modding at that point, differentiability will not be there. Modding a function at those points, when you mod it, at those points where the function was becoming 0, it will not be differentiable for sure. Mod x plus 2. Is it differentiable at minus 2? No. You will always see a sharp turn in the graph. Is the idea clear? Okay. Apart from this, even if a function is not showing discontinuity, it is not showing kink, it is not showing corner, but it has an infinite slope. Let me take a case like this. Okay. At x equal to a, this function is showing infinite slope. Then even at this point, f of x is not differentiable. Are you getting this point? That means f dash a will not exist.
So which function gives a graph like that?
There are many functions which can show the graph like this. In fact, sine inverse x. If I ask you what is f dash 1, what will you answer? If I just go by the graph, those who would have done inverse trig function, Pajwal, Suchinda, do you recall the graph was like this?
Yeah.
Correct? At one point, this is your one point. If you draw a tangent here, the tangent will have infinite slope. Okay? And at such points, the derivative of sine inverse x would not exist. Can I say same thing would be holding true even for minus one point?
Yeah.
If you draw a tangent over here, infinite slope tangent will come up. Okay? So sine inverse x will not be differentiable at 1 and minus 1 both. And it is not a surprise to me, because when you differentiate sine inverse x, we used to get 1 by root over 1 minus x squared. What will happen when you put x as 1? But let's say even if it is tending to 1, it will become a huge slope. Yes or no? Thereby the function will not be differentiable at 1. Okay. This can be treated as a very good example. Is that fine? So what is the moral of the story? We have taken so many cases, we have understood that when there are corners, when there are breakages in the graph, my function will not be differentiable. So ultimately, when you say a function f of x is differentiable at x equal to a, what's the final condition that I should keep in mind as a student who is going to write school exams? Yes. LHD is equal to RHD is equal to a finite value. Is equal to finite value. Of course, when they are equal, that quantity itself is called f dash a. When these two are equal, it itself is called f dash a, and hence f dash a will exist. If these two are not equal, or if these two are, one of them is not finite or infinite, we will not have a derivative at that point. Plain and simple. Period. Okay? The problem comes when students are asked to check the differentiability in an interval. Okay? So let's talk about the derivative of f of x in an interval. In an interval. Okay? We'll first talk about in open interval economy. When you say a function is differentiable, now again do not use words like the function is differentiable, the function is continuous. Never use these words because it will imply you are saying it is continuous or differentiable everywhere. Right? For example, if I say polynomial functions are always are continuous, which means it is continuous everywhere. As far as possible, always specify the interval or the point. Never state these things without an interval or a point. Right? Then it will have wrong meaning in the mind of a person who is listening to it. So when you say a function f of x is differentiable or f dash exists in an interval, open interval a comma b, what does it mean? For all c belonging to a comma b, the left hand derivative at c must be equal to the right hand derivative at c, and that must be finite. Okay? This is simple. But the problem arises if your interval were open. If the interval were closed. Because for points between a and b, things are fine. I don't worry about that. It will follow from this nature. Right? So, all c between a and b, between a and b, that's why I'm writing open brackets. This condition must hold true. Okay? But what about the corner points a and b themselves? Because at a, there is no left hand derivative. At b, there is no right hand derivative. So how do you say at b it is differentiable or not? Or how do you say at a it is differentiable or not?
Slope should be equal
at both the points. Why? They're so far apart.
Half of it
what? The thought process is correct, but the way you have worded it is very confusing. So, right handed, what should I do with that? I got a value, what should I do with
that? If it's finite.
Now, apart from this, you should have the right hand derivative at A should be finite, and left hand derivative at B should be finite. Please note this out. So in case of open interval, no problem. In case of closed interval, apart from it being differentiable in the open interval, even at the corner points it must be differentiable. And for corner points, it is sufficient for us to show that it has a finite slope at the corner points. That means right hand derivative at A should be finite and left hand derivative at B should be finite. Is that fine? Any questions so far? Now, before I start giving you questions, start solving questions, in general, I would like to take up the properties of differentiability, just like we did it in case of a continuity. Correct? So, in the entire chapter of continuity, what did we learn? Left hand limit at A should be right hand limit at A should be equal to the value of the function at A. Correct? In the entire chapter of differentiability, what is the bottom line? What is the core principle? Left hand derivative at A should be equal to the right hand derivative of A should be equal to a finite value. This is the whole chapter all about. The entire chapter revolves around these two simple statements. Keep it simple, you will remember it for life. The more you complicate it, the sooner you will forget it. Right? Brain is a very complex organ. It doesn't like to remember anything which pains it. That's why the moment your exam is over, you have forgotten everything. But the moment you start, you know, appreciating things and start enjoying things, that will remain for the whole of your life.